Hi, and welcome to this What's New in B1 Usability Package version 2019.04 video. This video has a ton of new things, so let's get started. First up, we have a major new feature, which is called HTTP Trigger. And this might be a little new to you, might be unclear, so we have a lot of additional videos about this as well next to this video. But what it essentially means is you can do what is called an HTTP post. And for the first version, to better understand it, this means you can post things to Microsoft Teams or to Slack. Usability Package will take care of that, and you just need to write like you would an email, like you would a message, like you would any other kind of thing, and we will post it to Microsoft Teams and Slack. This is just, however, just the beginning of what HTTP Trigger's idea is, and you will see a lot more during the year about what this feature can do at the end. It is part of Printer Leary in forms of a new report action called HTTP Trigger, and as part of a universal function, which is called HTTP Trigger. By far, you will probably see, once I show you some of the demos, that Printer Leary is by far the place you use it the most, but you can do it on universal functions as well. Again, lots of videos covering this, things like adding a birthday bot, so every time a user have a birthday in your Business One, it is posted to Microsoft Teams or Slack, top five sales employees during the week, and such and such. It's actually only your your ideas that set the limitations. And again, this is early days. Microsoft Teams and Slack is the primary focus right now, but any kind of system that have an HTTP API, Zendesk, other things will at some point come to this feature. So stay tuned. But again, see the videos if you find it at all interesting. Moving on to Printer Leary, where we have 7 new quality of life features. So let's go through them. The first one is a highly requested feature in certain countries. It's a little different from country to country if they use this feature or not. But the account balance, the aging report, as someone also calls it, we now have it for suppliers. So you are able to run the same account balance, but at the top here you can see there's your type, and you can choose if you want to use it for customers or for suppliers. Else it works exactly the same. We have guidelines on how you need to tweak your crystal reports, and out of the box crystal report will of course support the supplier part. Feature number 2 is also a highly requested feature, in that when you save a report right now in report actions, it always do an override. So if you have a PDF called a certain name and you resave over it, it will actually override that PDF. Now you have the option to go in and choose the save type if you want to save both, or you just want to override. So meaning if you have invoice 123 and you save it again, it would get a new name called invoice 123, parenthesis 1, parenthesis 2, and so on. So there's never something that is overwritten. That's of course a business decision if you want to do that or not, if you want to be able to see the history of the files like that. So up to you. By default it's still override, but you can go in and say keep both. Moving on to the third feature is that you now have the option to add the file to the document. So this is also for report action save, where you can now go and say attach file to document. So if you use this report action against a sales or purchase document, you will at the end of this report action end up with that PDF being attached to the document itself. In this case, you can see it's a my file here, and it's now attached in the normal attachment folder of SAP. So again, depending on if you want to be able to go to the sales order and actually see the PDF that was generated in the past. Moving on to feature number 4 in printer delivery, which is something called dynamic printer names. This is mostly because of remote desktops. So if you have remote desktops and you have printers that follow along into that remote desktop, they normally get a on-the-fly generated name. So if your printer name is called ABC, it will be called ABC redirected from. Then it will get a new name every time you do it. This means that it's very, very difficult to target a printer because it gets a new name every time. In our old system, you just gave the name. So now you can, in the report action, go down and say use dynamic printer name. And then you write the first part of it, because the redirect part will always come at the end. So you just write all the things that are the same every single time. And then we will figure out what the right printer is based on your prefix of that name. So it just starts with field down here. This means that you can now target these redirected printers in a system. Feature number 5 is in internal messages. This is shown from printer delivery report actions, but it also works in universal functions in this case. So I bundle them together here. So in the past, when you needed to send an internal message, you could just check the checkboxes on who you wanted to send it to. But that also gave the drawback of you couldn't set who it was dynamically. So for example, you couldn't set up that it was the current user that should receive the internal message, or you couldn't set up that it was the owner of the document, for example, or something. So now you have the option down here to, in addition to checking the fixed people who need to get the internal message, you can write SQL colon, you can write dynamic syntax down here in order to find your user. So your SQL should just give back the username of the user, and we will take care of sending to them. Feature number 6 is 2 new keywords. These 2 new keywords can be used in the new HTTP trigger, and they can also be used in report action emails. So they are called SQL bullet list and SQL numbered list. So this is to make lists in some kind of text, either in Teams Slack or in an email body. So as an example, you could write SQL numbered list, select top 3 from something, or top 5, top 10, whatever, and you would end up with a piece of text being like this, where each record given back to from that SQL with the first column would give a thing here, and bullets would just be stars instead of 1, 2, 3, of course. And the final little feature that comes to printer delivery is the exchange from mail. So in the exchange servers, you could not by default set up who the from mail was. It was always the ones based on the credentials. But if you have set it up in your exchange server that you allow to send from other email addresses being aliases, you can now write the from mail here. You can of course, as always, use dynamic syntax to figure out what it is, but of course you need to have it set up in your exchange server that you allow to do that, else it will fail. Let's move on to Quick Create. Quick Create have gotten a whole slew of new fields support. So for the header fields, you can now choose the industry fields, you can choose the foreign name. On the contacts, you can set up the first name, middle name, and last name, and you can now also set the gender. And finally, for the addresses, you can set up address field 2 and 3, the block, the building, and for US and Canada, you can now set the tax code as well. So as always, you just simply right click on Quick Create, go into the Quick Create configuration, and choose the fields you want to see. So you can see a few of them here, and it's just like all the other ones, check them off and you have them on the screen. Moving on to B1 dashboards. Dashboards have gotten 3 new features. The first one being that We have heard some feedback that some people would rather have the Fury cockpit on HANA, but they at the same time they would really really like the B1 dashboards as web. So we have of course the dashboard inside the B1 client, but if you turned it on you would get a warning message about you couldn't see the dashboards because you were running Fury cockpit. So now that that will not come along if you turn on Fury cockpit, so you can actually run both at the same time. We of course prefer you to have B1 dashboard all over the place, but we heard you loud and clear and you wanted to have the option, so we gave it to you. Second is more navigation. We have new navigations to transfers and transfers request, but also we have the new multi-object navigation. This you know from SQL reports, but in this case it's in dashboards now. It's a little more different and it's quite tricky to set up, so we have made a video on that, so please see that separately. But the idea is of course that if you have a list of data where there's for example both credit notes and invoices, or credit notes delivering and invoices, whatever you have, you should be able to double click on the number still and go to that relevant type. So if I double click a credit note, it should go to credit note. If I double click an invoice, it should go to invoice. This is now possible. Again, see the documentation because it requires quite a few steps of you, but it is possible to do if you have that customer demanding that. And finally, a very small quality of life thing is that whenever you add a new dashboard now, dashboard widget, it will be active as default and it will be web-enabled as default, because a lot of people added the web dashboard and couldn't really figure out why they weren't shown any of their dashboards. And that was because web-enabled was off by default. In new installations, they will now be on by default, and all new dashboards the check mark will be on. You can of course take it off if you don't want it to be web enabled, but it's just many people forgot, so now we do it automatically. Moving on to universal functions and one of the most highly requested features on our community. This is a dynamic code where you are able to write your own C# code or VB code. And we now support our store values, which you normally know from macros. They are now being accessible. You simply just write the @store somewhere in your text and it will understand that that needs to be replaced just like the dynamic syntax will be replaced. And also at the same time we are now supporting the variable support, so the %0, %1 and so on, just like in SQL report, in Crystal, and macros and all the different places. You simply go in and write them, define how what they should work with, and then before executing your code it will show that system I'm running. Like macros, these are non-blocking, so be aware of those restrictions. More of that in the F1 help, but this is really for the nerds, these features. But again, highly requested, and if you ask for it and a lot of people do, we deliver. General, we also have the addition to export additional objects. So what is this? So for example, in B1 validation system, when you do an export, in the old days you just exported the different validation systems. But a B1 validation system, of course, are tied to the universal functions. So you now have the option to check, use the check mark down here to say, hey, while exporting these, please also export the tied universal functions. So in this case, this one is running this universal function, which actually also runs another universal function. And the system is intelligent enough to know that. So it will say, hey, if you export this and you choose this along, I will also export the two universal functions that comes along with this. So just a matter of preferences and how you want to export things. It's not every single one of them that are being enabled in this release, but we will enable them along the way, so every single one of our systems that also have sub types will have the option to export as well in the same go. And with that, that's all we have to show today. We have minor things as well, of course, always explained in the what's new or in the version history. But else, the preview is out now, as always, on the preview URL. And the final release is set to 8th of April 2019 on the normal download page. So with that, thank you for watching, and I hope you will enjoy the new features.